Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick coming to you from the Philippines. You know, they have a motto here, more fun in the Philippines. That's their motto. Well, you know, and I always think to myself and I always say, you know, to Filipino people that, yeah, it's more fun if you're drunk. The amount of people who are drunk here, brothers and sisters, is of men. The alcoholism rate in the Philippines is probably 70 or 80%. Those of you who have watched my videos, I've talked about it before. It's really the problem here. You know, it's like one of those, which came first, the chicken or the egg? People say the problem in the Philippines is, you know, there's no jobs, no opportunity, hopelessness. And then the root of that is because the government is so corrupt. And the root of that is because the politicians have no morality. And the root of that is because they're not Christians. The root of that is because the Philippines is less than 5% born-again Christian. So that's the real root cause, is the country is less than 5% born-again Christian. So when you look at all the other things, like alcoholism being so high, you're looking at a symptom. And the Lord doesn't deal with the fruit. He deals with the root, brothers and sisters. So, you know, it's not something that's easily explained, because it's not meant for everybody to totally understand it, brothers and sisters. It depends on what God calls you to do. You know, and then there's different things that the Lord would have people do as pastors. You know, you're really talking about pastors. And then like my ministry, a prophetic ministry, the Lord has shows me the root. Either shows me the root or speaks to me like a word of wisdom, word of knowledge. What's the root of situations going on? Now, that's I made a video the other day talking about spiritual warfare, going from the flesh to the spirit. And that's the whole thing, brothers and sisters. Let me say this. It's like the analogy where it says, you know, give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day, and teach him how to fish, he'll fish for a lifetime. And when I had started, not when I started the ministry, when I started working with Filipino people in the U.S., I planted two or three Filipino churches, and I helped plant another Filipino church. They're all there, still churches in North Carolina, Piedmont area of North Carolina, in Greensboro and Winston-Salem. And I work with Filipino, there's a network of Filipino churches all over North Carolina, Raleigh and different places. And also, you know, did some revivals with them and different stuff. And anyway, with the churches that I started, brothers and sisters, I used to, the preaching that I do, brothers and sisters, is to teach people how to fish, not give them a fish. And that's the whole thing, brothers and sisters, that the whole root of the ministry that the Lord gave me is to teach you about God and the deeper things of God, or the higher things of God, however you want to look at it. Those things of God that's not on the surface level, that the goal of making disciples, one of the goals, let me say that, because the ultimate goal is for people to be conformed to the image of Christ, okay? And that's people make that a cliche. You know, lifelong career, hard shell, denominational, you know, Christians conform to the image of Christ. They love to say that, but it becomes a cliche for people. And what does it mean? It means that when you, if you are a mature Christian and you've been discipled, and you come, you know, you don't need to ask me or ask any pastor, you know, what do I do about this, you know, this situation that's in the flesh, a small situation. You don't need to ask, because you already know. You see what I'm saying? You already know the principles of God, the Word of God, the principles of God. So the principles of God go throughout, you know, the root of what God wants us to do and the root of what God is. And the foundation, you know, is righteousness and justice are the foundation of His thrones, of His throne. The Lord, you know, without love, you know, I'm nothing in the New Testament. So, you know, I could go through all those things, but in this video, I'm not going to sit here and go through all those. See, because again, people want me to teach them, give them a fish. But again, I want to give you a revelation of who is God. And that's really what I do with all the preaching that I do. 99% of the time, unless I'm talking to non-believers, then you're talking about evangelism and stuff, giving them some baby food. But when you're talking about Christians growing in the faith, and Christians, as a matter of fact, many, many people who watch videos on YouTube are mature Christians, or should be. I'll say that they're long-term Christians. Might not necessarily be mature Christians, but long-term Christians. Still operating out there in the flesh. And brothers and sisters, that's the kind of stuff that I see every day on YouTube. You know, and thank God, you know, it's a blessing. I'm in the Philippines. The internet's pretty slow here. And I can only watch videos like after midnight, you know. So that's, sometimes I'll get on a kick or get on a binge, whatever, start watching some videos, especially if the Lord led me to watch those videos of different things, different topics. You know, I start watching videos. Most of the time, you know, I can't hardly watch videos. And thank the Lord for that. You know, it keeps me from a lot of nonsense. I only find out what's going on by messages from people. What's the deal? You know, from different people. And so anyway, brothers and sisters, I just made a video the other day about spiritual warfare. And, you know, I want to talk about something else, but the Lord led me to talk about this. We have to learn to become mature in the faith, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. Starting at verse 11, it says, the Lord gave some apostles, prophets, you know, evangelists, pastors and teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, till we all come together, you know, to the mature body of Christ, you know, till we won't be tossed to and fro by every wind and doctrine, so that we will become mature in the stature of the body of Christ. And brothers and sisters, all of the stuff that I see in churches and on YouTube, no different, it's all a bunch of flesh and immaturity. Brothers and sisters, we must walk above those things and beyond those things. You know, we all, you know, go through situations where, you know, the enemy will attack us and try to pull us down into the flesh. And what's supposed to happen is we would learn from that, as I mentioned in the last video. And the Lord is bringing me back to this message. I had two different messages to give, and this was not one of them. But the Lord is always like that. He's even reminded me what I said in the other video. After I make a video, I get a word from the Lord. I can never remember what I said unless the Lord brings it to my memory. You know, thank God for that. You know, praise God. And that's part of being mature in the Lord, is to be able to, you know, try to keep yourself a clean vessel, you know, and not have your own prejudices and preconceived ideas involved, and let the Lord lead you. But in the last video I made, two videos ago, and there's a picture of the sword, the armor of God on there, I talked about King David. And so before King David, who was still a teenager at the time, they say about 17, before he killed Goliath the giant, first he killed the lion and the bear. So first he killed a lion or a bear. I don't think it says which order. He killed one. I would say the bear. Let's just say the bear is probably weaker than the lion, whatever. You know, let's don't discuss that. For God's sakes, please, for the love of all things sacred, as they say, let's please not discuss which is more tough and which is more hard to defeat, the lion or the bear. Because I guarantee there's none of you who's watching this who's ever fought a lion or a bear or a giant. So, but now spiritually, yes, some of you have. And those who have, by the grace of God, have matured from that. That's what I'm talking about. Those of you who need to hear this, obviously, you're not mature in the faith, and that's why you need to hear it. And those of you who are mature in the faith can be the amen corner and the amen choir. You know, amen. Can I get an amen? Can I get a witness from those who have been through something for the living God? And I guess before you can defeat the lion, you have to defeat the giant. You have to defeat the lion and the bear. Then, you know, the Lord would mature you. You make it through that. It would grow you, develop you, and you would increase in your abilities to fight the good fight of faith and lay hold of eternal life. But most people who watch this, you know, this is why, you know, my subscriber count is not as high as some other people, because I'm not a people pleaser. I always try to speak the truth as the Lord would lead me. And that's what it is. The majority of you, brothers and sisters, the majority of you have been sitting back, as they used to say in the Marines. My little brother was in the Marines. I was in the Army. Like they used to say in the Marines, you know, the drill sergeants would say, you know, you're just all sitting back all fat and happy. You know, you got your big screen TV. You got your easy chair. You know, your what they call an armchair quarterback. You're back there kicking it and chilling in a first world country. Everything's been handed to you on a silver spoon. You know, your life has been mostly, you know, peaches and cream. And then to you, a tragedy, you know, is you broke a fingernail. A spiritual warfare, you broke a fingernail. You know, or your car, you know, the battery was dead in your car last year. and it was a mighty spiritual move of God to get it fixed. That's the average person that I minister to. They have not fought the fight for the Lord. They've let other people fight the fight. And what I'm trying to tell you, just like with King David, I mean, that's the truth. Way it always happens, just like with King David. You know, the whole army of Israel was out there like a bunch of morons, shaking in their boots, and even King Saul, who was a head taller than everybody else, and he was like a giant compared to other people. Of course, he wasn't as tall as Goliath, but it said, the Bible says he's a head taller than anybody else in all of Israel. You know, old King Saul. And all the army, even two or three of the brothers of King David were there. That's why King David came to the camp to bring some food to his brothers and check on them, see how they were doing. Got sent from his dad to go check on his older brothers there. You know, he had like seven brothers. He went there to check on some of them who were there fighting in the army. And they're all out there shaking in their boots and scared to death of Goliath. And then here's this teenage boy who was a runt. You know, he said, he heard what Goliath was saying. Hey, you guys are a bunch of losers. You're a bunch of wimps, you know. Send out somebody to fight me. If you defeat me, then, you know, you guys will win. And if I defeat you, then, you know, we have the victory over Israel. He was their champion, you know. They used to have those kind of things, a champion contest instead of everybody fighting, just the champions of each country. And then here's little ruddy King David, who had been anointed king, but he was not king yet in the flesh. But spiritually, he was already made the king by God. Hey, that's a whole nother sermon I could teach on. He had already been made the king by God, but he had not grown in the natural experience. Just like Joseph, you know, had the dream when he was a young man, a teenager, that he would rule and reign over his brothers, but it hadn't happened yet. In the natural, he had to grow and develop and be sold as a slave and go into prison, all those things, before he could go from the pit to the palace. You know, he had to be prepared over 20 years. And so anyway, here's David, who had been anointed as king but not realized it. No one knew who he was. He was a nobody in the natural. And then when he heard what Goliath said about, I'm going to kick everybody's hind end, you guys are a bunch of wimps and blah, blah, blah. Then King David said, you know, who is this uncircumcised Philistine to challenge the armies of the living God? He asked the question King Saul should have been asking. He asked the question that his older brothers who were teasing him. Oh, you know, and that's what his brother said to him. Oh, what did you do? Come out here to try to show off and start some trouble? You need to go back and watch that little old herd of sheep you got back there, boy. You know, that's what they said to him. And then King Saul tried to mock him too and said, oh, here, put on my armor. You know, here's David, a short little runt teenager, and then here's King Saul, the tallest man in all of Israel. And, you know, the armor on him would be like, it's a joke. He couldn't even walk around in it. They were mocking him. They were mocking David, you know. And then, you know, in the flesh, King David was like a little bitty runt dude. But in the spirit, he was used mightily by God. And so that's a whole other message. But the message for you guys that I'm trying to put across from the living God right now is the fact that it was only David. Every time you look, there's only a few people. Even on the day of Pentecost, there was only 120 people in the upper room. And the Bible tells us that more than 500 people at one time saw the resurrected Lord Jesus. Not counting all the other people that saw him here and there and here and there. We don't know how many people saw Jesus after his resurrection. At least 500. At least 500. But in the upper room, there was only 120. So that's why I laugh, sadly, when I hear people get the mentality, well, there's some guy on YouTube, he's got 50, 60, 75, 80,000, 100,000 subscribers. Or whatever. Or somebody on television, you know, they're... Dr. G. James Kennedy, the Presbyterian church down there in Coral Gables, Florida. You know, his church was, you know, over 12,000 people or whatever. You know, Joel Osteen, that's the example that we should use, of course. Easy target, right? Joel Osteen's got, whatever, 50,000 member church. He said, woo! People judge according to the flesh and not according to the spirit. Jesus only had 120 in the upper room. So was he a failure? No, in the spirit, he already had the victory. In the flesh, it appears to those who are in the flesh, those who do not know how to fish, it appears that they were not given a fish in those situations. When Noah had the ark, there, he says in the New Testament, we learned that Noah preached for 120 years, and he had no converts, only his immediate family, only his three sons and their wives and him and his wife. Only eight people was on the ark. So according to the flesh, Noah was a failure. But in reality, he did the will of God. We see this over and over and over again. Elijah and the 500 prophets of Baal. Jezebel had 500 prophets, and then there was only one Elijah. You know, and then the people turned to Elijah when they saw the fire fall from heaven. When Jesus fed the 5,000, and you know, I'm seeing where the Lord's going with this. John chapter 6, when Jesus fed the 5,000, he departed from them in the middle of the night. He sent his disciples across the Sea of Galilee in a ship, and then he stayed and prayed, and then he came later on. And then, you know, that's when he walked on the water and all that. Then when he got to the other side, they were like, well, they were following him. And Jesus said, hey, you're only following me because you like the bread and the fish. See? And that's why I used to do feeding programs when I first started in the Philippines, and I stopped the feeding programs down to just a trickle over the since I got here in 2007. And the first time I came 2005, 2006, 2004, 2005, 2006, I came on short-term missions. I did feedings and all that stuff, and I'd stopped in 2009 because of that very thing. But the Lord had me reinstitute it for children, in 2012 because the Lord gave me a new commission for Joshua's ministry, suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not. The Lord wants to feed the little children because they don't know any better. But he's talking about grown people, adults. They were only following Jesus for the bread and the fish, not to learn how to be fishers of men. That's what they're looking for. They could not suffer the hard sayings of Christ. That's why Jesus dealt with them swiftly, and he said, you know, I am the bread of life that comes down from heaven. And they said, oh, our fathers, you know, you say you came down from heaven. We know who? Joseph and Mary. They said, you know, we know Joseph and Mary. We know you came from Nazareth. What do you mean you came down from heaven? And that's why Jesus told them, your fathers ate manna in the wilderness, but later on they died. But this bread, if you eat it, is such a kind. If you eat it, you'll never die. You know, and they couldn't understand it was a spiritual. The Lord Jesus went on to say, as he said, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Now, Roman Catholicism takes that to cannibalism and says that what they call transubstantiation, that you literally eat the flesh and blood of Christ. But right there in John chapter 6, Jesus goes on to say, these things are spiritual things I'm talking about. It's a hard saying. Why did Jesus say those things? Because he wanted to get rid of the tares. Jesus got rid of the tares just like that when he said something in the spirit and not addressing to the flesh. The fish and loaves of bread, hey, it says they were ready to make him king of Israel. Then when he started talking hard spiritual stuff, they turned around and walked away. In Galilee, when he got to Jerusalem and he started talking spiritual stuff, they crucified him. Why? Because people want their flesh fed. They want their eyes fed with eye candy, their ears tickled with ear candy, but they don't want to hear what the Spirit says unto the church. That's why Jesus proclaimed in the Gospels over and over again, he spoke in parables so that the people could not understand him. They said, why do you speak in parables? So that to whom, you know, so you can understand, but not these people that are in the flesh. Only those who have an ear can hear what the Spirit says unto the church. So I will say this. As advice to you guys, and lots of people who watch me are, you know, you kind of have a prophetic calling and gifting, and that's why we're associated. God associates like-minded people, as they say, birds of a feather flock together. And I'll give you some advice. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the church. Most people do not have an ear to hear. Most people will do their own will. Even as Jesus told us plainly in the Gospels, wide is the road, and broad is the road that leads to destruction. But straight is the way, and narrow is the gate that leads to eternal life. And few, Jesus said, and few are those who find it. And few are those who find it. That's why if you come on with some soft ice cream, you know, an ice cream social, a softball grinning message, like I'm using him because, you know, it's always the, you know, the easiest target, Joel Osteen. You use a soft ice cream, you know, grinning message, you're going to get all those tears. And that's a whole other thing here. The reason what's wrong with these churches, people talk, oh, prosperity gospel and all this, move all those peripheral issues out of the way. The problems with the churches is they're not preaching the Word of God. They are not giving the gospel of Jesus Christ. What they're giving is the people what they want to hear. You know, it's just like what Julius Caesar did. You know, you talk about MSG. What they did is they made MSG, which they make out of, you know, rotten fish guts, just a FYI there, monosodium glutamate, and then people are addicted to it. People in the Philippines love MSG. That's one reason why the people, average person dies at less than 60 years old here in the Philippines. Because of they love MSG and everything. I mean by the handfuls. It's addictive. Makes you look like a prune when you keep eating it. And anyway, they put MSG in the bread and gave away free bread, and then they had to, you know, fed the lions, the Christians to the lions and all that. They had all that, you know, those sporting events at the Colosseum. Give the masses what they want. Why Rome burns, why Rome crumbles. Give the masses what they want. And that's what's happening in the church today, brothers and sisters. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church. The masses are being fed MSG-laden bread instead of giving that true manna, that true bread, the bread of life, Yeshua HaMashiach, that bread of life that if you eat it, you'll never see death. Hallelujah. For Jesus has conquered death, hell, and the grave. The world, the flesh, and the devil are under his feet through his precious blood shed for us on Calvary's cruel cross, as they say. Not as a cliche, as they say, but it is the cruel cross of Calvary that our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed his innocent blood for you and me that we might be saved. And what the world don't want to hear is what Jesus said. Part of the good news is the bad news. You're lost and without hope in this world, and you need to be born again. Before a man can enter the kingdom of heaven, he must be born again, says the Lord Jesus Christ. John chapter 3, verse 3. That's the thing about in the Philippines. You say born again, they say, oh, they think it's a denomination. It's a cult. Oh, they're born again. You know, they'll say, oh, those people are born again. You know, they don't want to be Catholics. They want to be born again. No, Jesus said before you could enter the kingdom of heaven. Not some man said that. Not some philosophy or denomination. Jesus said, John chapter 3, verse 3, before a man can enter the kingdom of heaven, he must be born again. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Lord Jesus Christ said unto his own church, right there written in his word. And then Nicodemus in the flesh, this guy's a leader in Israel. That's the point that the Lord gave me a minute ago. The Lord is leading me right back to it. Nicodemus, here is a guy who is a leader in the Sanhedrin, one of the smartest people, most educated people in Judaism, in all of Israel, you know, from a special family, you know, and he says, how can a man be born again? He needs to go back in his mother's womb? I mean, how dense and how much in the flesh can one person be, a grown man, to say that? You're going to go back in your mother's womb? That's why Jesus said to him, for one thing, the reason why Jesus used that expression, he must be born again, because this guy, Nicodemus, was born from a special family. And that's the problem with all this stuff on the internet, of all this sacred namer stuff and all this, one of the big pitfalls of the Jewish roots movement. Because Nicodemus thought he was going to heaven because he was from a special family. Because he was from that family that was part of these, you know, the Sanhedrin, like a royalty in those days in that group. Because he was Jewish, because he was educated in the Torah and trying to keep the law and all that, he thought he was going to heaven because of that. But what did Jesus set the Judaizers on YouTube today straight right there in that text, instead of addressing what Nicodemus said to him? I say I'm going into another message. Nicodemus came to Jesus by night and said, we know you must come from God because no one can do the things you do except they come from God. Did Jesus say, yeah, you're right, I came from God because look at the signs and wonders I did? No, he didn't. Jesus addressed Nicodemus for him to have an ear to hear what Jesus was saying to him, what he needed to hear, specifically as somebody who thought he was somebody, who thought he was a big deal because of the way he was born, because of his bloodline. He thought he was special. But Jesus said to him, except a man be born again, the bloodlines you came from, because you're circumcised, because you're an Israelite, because you came from a famous family, because you're on the Sanhedrin, it means nothing. As Paul said, account it all as dung. That's poop of animals for the sake of knowing Jesus. It's all dung. It's all nonsense. It's all foolishness. It's all perishing except for knowing Jesus Christ. Now, what Jesus went on to say, and it's the same thing, the theme of this message that the Lord gave me that I had no idea I was going to give. The message is that later on in that text, Jesus said, if you can't understand these simple concepts about being born again, if you can't understand these earthly things, you know, the manifestation of what God's wisdom does in the earth, like, hey, you need to be born again. If you can't understand that, how can I tell you about heavenly things when you can't even understand the most basic concept of being a follower of Jesus? And that is the reason why the churches are weak and powerless and have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof, because they can't get past the rudiment, elementary doctrines of Christianity. As it tells us in Hebrews, we need to move beyond baptism and being saved and repentance and all that. Move on off the milk. I believe that's Hebrews chapter 6. To the sincere meat of the word. And that's what is wrong on YouTube. And that's what is wrong in the churches today. The people are on milk. They say, give me breast milk. Dear pastor, breastfeed me. Coddle me. Baby me. Don't let that bright light shine in my face. Keep me in the dark. Keep me in the dim light. Because Jesus said in that same text, as the Lord has given me these parables or these metaphors and bringing me right back to the same text, in the same text of John chapter 3, because men love darkness rather than light. They know that if their deeds are brought to the light, then it will be seen. But I got a message for you from the living God, that what you do in the dark shall be brought to the light. For the Lord himself knows what you're doing, and the foundations of his throne is righteousness, and justice are the foundations of his throne. And he will bring every deed to light. Every idle word you shall give an account for, says the Lord in his word. And by his spirit I speak to you right now. The judgment of the living God is coming swiftly, as a swift horse going out about the third hour of the day, says the Lord. It'll come unto you swiftly and overtake you and destroy you unless you repent right now. Turn from your wicked ways. Turn from the path that you're on and turn to the living God. Hallelujah. Rise from the dead, you sleepy Christians, and Christ will give you life. Ye lukewarm, you are vomit in the mouth of Christ, and he shall surely vomit you out of his mouth, you unholy Laodicean salt that has lost its savor, that's good for nothing but the dunghill. And the Lord is just speaking to me right now, just like the wife of Lot. He turned her to salt when she looked back at Sodom. The Lord, the angel told them, go and don't look back. She looked back and the Lord turned her to salt. Why? That it would be a witness that she was supposed to be salt and light in that Sodom. But she was a failure at the commission that the Lord gave her. Therefore, the Lord brought swift judgment upon her and upon their whole family. Their life was ruined because they refused to be salt and light. And they were brought into condemnation from their actions that they did. Brothers and sisters, God bless you. God bless you. For those who have an ear, let them hear what the Spirit says unto the church. May the light of the Lord shine upon you. May you be set free. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. You know, I praise God, because the victory in spiritual warfare is not to be bound. You know, there are people that try to bind you. And the devil and his people try to bind the message of God. But just as the Apostle Paul said when he was literally in jail in chains, he said the Spirit of God cannot be bound. You know, you can bind me and put me in prison. You can do what you want to. But the Spirit of God cannot be bound. It can't be locked up. You know, if people try to jam me up, God will get somebody else. God don't need me. He's using me, but he don't need me. He can get somebody else anytime. Boom. Hallelujah. God owns everything. Don't you think God can't turn anybody and use anybody for his glory any way, anytime he wants? Hallelujah. Praise his holy name. I want you to praise him and bless him. Hallelujah. Praise you, God Almighty. Hallelujah. Through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Bless his holy name. Brothers and sisters, maybe I'll be back to do the other videos that the Lord gave me. We'll see. I want to do a part two about the things that's going, you know, about this stuff the Lord showed me, about the video I made about the rise of the Antichrist and all about the Washington Monument and all those kind of things and sacred geometry and all those other things that the Lord has had me been studying, so people can learn, because the Bible says we're not ignorant of Satan's plans, Satan's devices. God bless you guys. You know that I love you. And those who are in the Spirit, they understand that when you're speaking by the Spirit, you're bold, can be aggressive. And those of you who are used to being Joel Osteen and being titty fed, breastfed, of course it can be hurtful. You got to receive it in your heart, not in your flesh. God bless you guys.